Integrated weed management. Dear students, in this session, let me introduce the concept of integrated weed management. At the end of the session, you will be able to explain the concept of integrated weed management and IWM in that means integrated weed management in agriculture and horticultural crops. First, we are going to have introduction about the integrated weed management. An integrated weed management may be defined as the combination of two or more weed control methods at low input levels to reduce the weed competition in a given cropping system below the economic threshold level. It has proved to be a valuable concept in a few cases, though much is still to be done to extend it to the small farmers level. Integrated weed management approach aims at minimizing the residue problem in plants, soil, air and water. An integrated weed management involves the utilization of a combination of mechanical, chemical and cultural practice of weed management in a planned sequence so designated as not to affect the ecosystem. The nature and intensity of the species to be controlled, sequence of crops that are raised in rotation, the standard of crop husbandry and the ready and timely availability of any method and the economics of different weed management techniques are some of the potent considerations that determines the success for the exploitation of the IWM approach. Next, we are going to discuss about the necessity of integrated weed management. One method of weed control may be effective and economical in a particular situation, it may not be so in other situation. And next one is, no single herbicide is effective in controlling wide range of weed flora. Third one is, continuous use of same herbicide creates resistance in escaped weed flora or causes shift in the flora. Continuous use of only one practice may result in some undesirable effects. Only one method weed control may lead to increase in population of particular weed species. Indiscriminate herbicide use and its effect on the environment and human health. Next, the concept of integrated weed management. Use a variety of technologies in a single weed management with the objective to produce optimum crop yield at a minimum cost, taking into consideration of ecological and socio-economical constraints under a given ecosystem. A system in which two or more methods used to control the weeds. These methods may include cultural practice, natural enemies and selective herbicides. Next, definition for the integrated weed management. Integrated weed management is a method whereby all economically, ecologically and toxicologically justifiable methods are employed to keep the harmful organisms below the threshold level of economic damage, keeping in the foreground the conscious employment of natural limiting factors. IWM is the rational use of direct and indirect control methods to provide cost-effective weed control. Among the commonly suggested indirect methods are land preparation, water management, plant spacing, seed rate, cultivar use, fertilizer application. Direct methods include manual, cultural, mechanical and chemical methods of weed control. There are more experimental evidence are available which shows that better weed control is achieved if different weed control practices are used in combination rather than if they are applied separately. Next, the good integrated weed management program are, first one is flexible enough to incorporate innovations and practical experience of local farmers, and developed for the whole farm, not for just one or two fields, and it should be extended to irrigation channels, roadsides and other non-crop surroundings on the farm from where most weeds find their way into the crop fields, economically viable and practically feasible. The advantages of integrated weed management, it shifts the crop weed competition in favor of crop, prevents the weed shift towards perennial nature, prevents resistance of weeds to herbicides, no danger of herbicide residue in soil or plant, no environmental pollution, gives higher net return, suitable for high cropping intensity. So, integrated weed management includes the following control methods of weed that are applied as part of integrated weed management. First one is the biological control. Biological control, as it applies to weed management, is the use of plant feeding insects, pathogens or diseases that are host specific to invasive weed species with the intention of suppressing the weed population. Biological control does not intend to eradicate the target weed species, but instead is used to bring the plant into balance with the rest of the landscape. It is intended to be cost effective for the long term solution of weed management. It may take several years for biological control agents to establish, but once their population begins to build up at appropriate levels, they provide long term suppression and reduce weed management costs significantly. Leaf spurge, purple loosestrife and spotted knapweed are examples of invasive weed species where biological control is successfully being used in Minnesota. Next, we are going to discuss about chemical control. Chemical control is use of synthetic or naturally occurring compounds that are applied to invasive weed species with the intent of killing them. Chemicals range in selectivity to certain types of plants, their persistence within the environment. Herbicides are typically applied in dry or liquid forms. Some types of herbicides are applied before weed germinate, that is called as pre-emergence or pre-emergent, and others are applied after germination, that is called as post-emergent. Chemical controls usually short-term solutions to weed problems. In some cases, herbicides have to be reapplied annually. Certain weed species can begin to develop resistance or tolerance to specific chemicals. Furthermore, large scale application can be expensive and detrimental to the environment. However, when herbicides are used on a selective basis or as part of IWM program, they are a very useful tool for managing weed problems. Next, we are going to discuss about mechanical control of weed. Mechanical control consists of using machines or other human-made tools to suppress weeds. Mowers, cultivators, saws, racks, etc. are all examples of tools commonly used in mechanical weed management. The use of hand tools to physically pull or destroy weeds can be a very successful approach to managing small infestation of weeds. However, hand tools alone are impractical on large scale weed problems. Mechanical controls like cultivating and mowing are generally used in larger population of weeds to inhibit growth or reduce seeding. When used as part of an IWM program, targeted mechanical controls can play an important role in overall weed suppression. Next, some of other control methods that are used in weed management are other ways to manage weeds by altering the landscapes through human intervention. Three good examples of this would include using fire through prescribed burns to promote healthy regrowth of prairies, manipulation of water levels to promote healthy establishment of native wetland species, And the last one is multi-species grazing using combinations of livestock like sheep and goat that have developed a palliative for noxious weeds. In each case, weeds are managed through fire, flooding or grazing, resulting in increased native or desirable vegetative regrowth, which increases competition for noxious or invasive plants, thus leading to healthier habitats. So, the take-home message is that each type of weed control has its advantage and disadvantages. The goal of any noxious or invasive IWM program should be to combine the advantages of each control method to successfully suppress the population of undesirable plant species. In most cases, successful IWM projects save money, reduce non-target impacts, protect natural resources and provide long-term sustained control than using any one management techniques by itself. Integrated weed management in agriculture crops. In this, so we are going to discuss about 5 principles by which we can design the IWM programs that are effective at reducing the opportunities for agriculture weeds to establish and become problematic. Some of them are: prevention is key, increase natural weed mortality, don't feed the weeds, keep weeds of balance, use as many little hammers as possible. Let us discuss this principle in detail. Prevention is key. There is a need to limit seed introduction, production and dispersal. Preventing weeds from establishing in the first place is perhaps the most effective way to minimize weed problem in crop fields. Using certified seeds, cleaning farm equipment after use in an infested field are two simple sanitation practices that prevent weeds from entering or spreading through fields. Removing weeds before they produce seeds, either through spot spraying or tillage or mowing, and collecting weed seeds in chaff wagons pulled behind the combine can also help to reduce the spread of weeds within or among the fields. Next one is increase natural weed mortality. There is need to enhance the abundance and effectiveness of natural enemies of weeds. During the life cycle of a weed, many mortality factors threaten its survivorship. Since it is unlikely that all weeds can be prevented from establishing in your fields, it is important to maximize the effectiveness of the mortality factors that exist naturally within your field. For example, studies have shown that weed seeds that are not protected by burial in the soil are more prone to destroyed by ground beetle, mice, fungi, bacteria or desiccation. Maximizing the magnitude and impact of these mortality factors can be an important component of successful IWM program. Next one of the principle is don't feed the weeds. There is a need to maximize resource use by crops. Crops and weeds compete for the same basic resources, that is sunlight, nutrients, water and space. A key component in the design of successful IWM program is to make sure that these resources are captured by the crop and not by the weeds. Several practices can help to ensure that your crops have the advantage. Let us discuss few of them. First one, apply fertilizer appropriately. Banding fertilizer near the crop row and applying it at the appropriate time enhances the ability of a crop to compete with the weeds. For example, band placement of fertilizer in the root zone has been shown to increase early plant growth and grain yield and decrease weedy grass population. These effects are particularly pronounced in reduced tillage systems. Next one principle is adjusting planting densities and row widths. Decreasing row spacing and or increasing seeding rates enhances the competitiveness of the crop relative to the weeds, particularly to early in the growing season, so that fewer resources are available to support weed growth. Research showed that Wild oat seed production decreased as barley seed rate increased from 67 to 150 pounds per acre, or in terms of kg per hectare, it is 75 to 175. Next one of the principle is keep weeds off balance. There is need for not allowing the weeds adapt to your weed management practices. Using the same crop rotation over and over again generates the predictable environmental conditions that are exploited by weeds. For example, jointed goat grass thrives in winter wheat fallow rotations because it has growth requirements that are very similar to winter wheat. Likewise, early germinating weeds such as wild oat can be found in early seeded cereals, and late germinating species such as pickweed can be problem in late seeded canola. The next and last principle is use as many as little hammers as possible to achieve maximum long term weed management. Conventional cropping system tend to rely on one or two large hammers such as herbicides and tillage for weed management. These practices provide short term control of weeds. Unfortunately, over the long term, these large hammers are not entirely effective because weeds are able to adapt to their predictability. Instead of a few large hammers, growers can employ multiple management practices. Many little hammers, such as adjusting seed rates, directed nutrient placement, crop rotation, and enhancement of natural weed mortality factors to manage weeds. Example for integrated weed management in agriculture crops. Here, use of herbicide butachlor at the rate of 2.5 liter per hectare, or thiobencarb 2.5 liter per hectare, or flucloralin 2 liter per hectare, or pendimethalin 3 liter per hectare, or anilofos 1 liter per hectare as pre-emergence application. That is followed by hand weeding, that is mechanical weeding, on 30 to 35 days after transplanting will have a broad spectrum of weed control in transplanted rice. Next, we are going to discuss about weed management in vegetable crops. Traditionally, vegetable growing areas are usually situated adjacent to waterways, floodplains, river deltas, marsh zones, and if herbicides are used, their environmental impact and usage conditions must be taken into account. Another aspect related to the complexity of herbicide use is its soil persistence that can seriously affect the next crops in the rotation as a result of soil residues or carryover. Vegetable rotations are very fast and intensive in many places, and herbicide toxicity can affect the next crop if the cycle of the previous crop is short enough. So, we have to consider all this aspect as well as consumer concerns on the probable presence of pesticide residues in fruit, leaves and roots of these crops, and strict limitation for marketing and export that can involve the hard labor and endurance of many workers. Therefore, a careful use of herbicide is compulsory and good field practices must be followed, especially when recognition of labeled production is desired. There is a great interest in the integration of tilling practices with chemical control because of the reduction of herbicide impact and the cost of hand labor. In vegetable seed production, we are following seed beds. Many vegetables are grown in seed beds to develop suitable seedlings for transplanting in the field. Soil dedicated to seed beds are usually light, with good tilth and fertilized to obtain a good plant emergence. Seed beds are usually flood irrigated and plastic protected. Here we add some possibilities for weed management in seed bed. First, one of the option available is steel seed bed. Steel seed bed are sometimes used for vegetable when other selective weed control practices are limited or unavailable. Basically, this technique consists of the following. First one is preparation of seed bed 2 to 3 weeks before planting to achieve maximum weed seed germination near the soil surface. Planting the crop with minimum soil disturbance to avoid exposing new wheat seed to favorable germination condition. Third one is treating the field with a non-residual herbicide to kill all germinated weeds just before or after planting, but before crop emergence. Next technique is the solarization of soil. Soil solarization is a broad spectrum control method, simple, economically feasible and environmental friendly. It is an effective method for the control of many weeds. It does not affect soil properties and usually produces higher yields. There are some disadvantages in its implementation. For example, previous irrigation is a requirement, that is frequent or abundant rain, and the soil must be kept soil solarized for a period of at least 1 month. Results are often variable depending upon weather condition. Cold, that is high latitude region, or cloudy places are usually not suitable for implementing soil solarization. Some species can tolerate soil solarization. Examples of deep-rooted perennials like sorghum halepens, cypress rotundus, and some big weeds such as legumes. Soil must be clean, surface leveled, and wet previously to being covered with a thin transparent plastic sheet and very well sealed. The soil must be kept covered during warmer and summer months for 30 to 45 days. Soil temperature usually exceeds above 40 degrees Celsius to exert a good effect on weed seed banks. After soil solarization, plastic must be recovered and the use of deep or mold-borne tillage must be avoided. This system is more suitable for small areas of vegetable, but it has been mechanized for extensive areas of tomatoes in some places. Soil solarization is widely used under plastic greenhouse conditions. Next, we are going to discuss about the chemical control in seed beds. There are even less registered herbicides for seed beds than for the use in crops. Herbicide treatments under plastic cover are always hazardous and careful application should be carried out. Under plastic, high levels of moisture and elevated temperature are common and plants grow very gently. Selectivity could be easily lost and phytotoxicity symptoms may occur, while sometimes they are just temporary. The effects are often erratic. The best way to deal with is to be prudent and make some trials before a general treatment. The selective pre-emergence and post-emergence herbicides used for vegetable seed beds are, for glumaxone is used to control the weeds in the seed beds of pepper and cucumber at the rate of 0.18 to 0.27 kg AI per hectare. Metribuzin is used at the rate of 0.15 to 0.5 kg AI per hectare for the tomato seed beds. Nepromide used at 1 to 2 kg per hectare for tomato, pepper and eggplants. Pendimethalin used at the rate of 1 to 1.6 for the crop of onion, garlic, lettuce. Propochlor used at the rate of 5.2 to 6.5 for onion and coal crops. Next, post-emergence herbicide. Normally, it is applied at 3 leaves of weeds. Glumaxone at the rate of 0.27 to 0.36 kg per hectare for pepper. Linoyuran for asparagus and carrots at the rate of 0.5 to 1 kg AI per hectare, metribuzin at the rate of 0.075 to 0.15 for tomato, oxyflofen, normally it is recommended for onion and garlic at the rate of 0.18 to 0.24 kg AI per hectare, rimsulfuran at the rate of 0.0075 to 0.015 kg AI per hectare for tomato crop. Next principle in vegetable crop production is crop rotation. Crop rotation is the programmed succession of different crops during a period of time in the same plot or field. It is a key control method to reduce weed infestation in vegetables. Crop rotation was considered for a long time to be a basic practice for obtaining healthy crops and good yields. At present, however, crop rotation is gaining interest and is of value in the context of integrated crop management. Classically, crop rotation are applied in the following context. Alternating crops with different types of vegetation. That means leafy crops followed by root crops, bulb crops, even fruit crops, etc. Then alternating with grass and dicots such as maize and vegetables. Next one practice is alternating different crop cycles, that is winter cereals followed by summer vegetables. Then fourth one is avoiding succeeding crops of the same family. That means same family should not be grown in succession in the same field. Example, Solanaceae crops, that is potato followed by tomato. Next one principle is alternating poor and high weed competitors, that is maize and potato, should be followed. That means we have to include poor and high weed competitors in rotation. Next principle and last principle is avoiding problematic weeds in specific crops, especially Malvaceae in carrots or parasitic and perennials in general. Next principle is mixed cropping. Growing two or more crops at the same time and adjacent to one another is called mixed cropping or intercropping. Advantages are a better use of space, sunlight and other resources. Physical production also ensured. Favorable thermal balance, better plant defense against some pests or fewer weed problems are some of the advantages. Sometimes the results are less productive than cultivating just one crop alone. Some examples are in tropical region, these are all the common rotations followed. Maize plus beans or squash can be intercropped. Tomato pigeon can be intercropped, sugarcane plus onion or sugarcane plus tomato can be intercropped as a weed control technique. Next principle is the preventive measures. It is necessary to avoid the invasion of new species through the use of clean planting material and to prevent seed dispersal and the irrigation water, implements and machines. A written record of the weed situation in the fields is very useful. Another aspect is to impede perennial weed dispersal, that is parasitic weeds, through the opportunistic use of treatments and tillage and the use of drainage tillage to prevent propagation of some species that need higher moisture levels. It is also necessary to scout the field edges to prevent invasions. Land preparation and tillage is the next principle. Suitable land preparation depends on a good knowledge of the weed species prevalent in the field. When annual weeds are predominant, that is mainly it includes crucifers, that is Solanum family and grass weeds, the objectives are unearthing and fragmentation. This must be achieved through shallow cultivation. If weeds have no dormant seeds, deep plowing to bury the weed seeds will be advisable. But if the seeds are produced or dormant, this is not a good practice because they will be viable again when they are returned to the soil surface after further cultivation. When perennial weeds are present, adequate tools will depend upon the types of rooting. That means pivot roots or bourgeon roots require fragmentation, and this can be achieved by using rotavator or cultivator. Next one is fragile resumes require dragging and exposure at the soil surface for their depletion, but flexible rhizomes require dragging and removal from the field. This can be done with a cultivator or harrow. Next principle is use of mulching material. The use of plastic mulching is very popular in many vegetable growing areas. A non-transparent plastic used to impede the transmission of photosynthetic radiation through the plastic to the weeds, so the development of weeds is then arrested. Next one is chemical weed control. The best approach to minimize inputs and to avoid any environmental problem is to apply herbicides in the crop row to a width of 10 to 30 centimeter. Many herbicides are effective in the control of perennial weeds. Sometimes a combination of two herbicides having a different weed control spectrum may be used. Mixtures of different herbicides are possible to achieve better efficacy, but previous trials are necessary. Their foliar activity is enhanced by adding a non-ionic surfactant or adjuvant. The use of any herbicide in vegetable requires previous tests to verify its effectiveness in local conditions and selectivity to available crop cultivars. In general, pendimethalin at the rate of 3.3 liter per hectare or fluchloralin at 2 liter per hectare or metalachlor 2 liter per hectare as pre-emergence herbicide is recommended for most of the vegetable crops, followed by one hand weeding at 30 days after transplanting. Some of the selective herbicides recommended for vegetable crops are alachlor at the rate of 2.4 kg AI per hectare as a post-emergence herbicide in brassica and onion, ethyl fluorolin at the rate of 0.8 and 1.7 as a pre-plant incorporation in tomatoes, pepper, beans and squash. Linoiran can be recommended at the rate of 0.5 to 1.25 kg AI per hectare as a pre-emergence herbicide for carrot, artichoke, asparagus and faba bean. Metribuzin can be recommended at the rate of 0.1 to 0.35 kg as a pre-emergence or post-emergence herbicide in tomato, carrots and beans. Oxyfluorphen at the rate of 0.36 to 0.48 kg can be recommended as a pre- or post-emergence herbicide in onion, garlic and cold crops. Oxyfluorphen can also be recommended for tomato, pepper at the rate of 0.24 to 0.48 kg AI per hectare as a pre-plant incorporation. Pendimethalin also can be recommended at the rate of 1.32 to 1.65 kg AI per hectare for artichokes, coles, lettuce, leek, pepper, tomato, onion, green peas, etc. Rimsulfuron can be recommended at the rate of 7.5 to 15 grams per hectare as a post-emergence herbicide in tomato crop. Trifluralin can be recommended 0.59 to 1.44 kg AI per hectare as a pre-plant incorporation in beans, carrots, cold crops, artichokes, onion, pepper, tomato, etc. Apart from chemical weeding, one hand weeding is done on 30 days after transplanting. Next, we are going to discuss about the biological control in vegetable production. Generally, mycoherbicides are a common preparation containing pathogenic spores applied as a spray with the standard herbicide application equipment. That means, example, a weevil for the aquatic weed Salvinia, rust for skeleton weed and a caterpillar to control prickly pear. Next, we are going to discuss about integrated weed management in horticulture crops. Horticulture crops are increasingly become very important in Indian economy. Weeds are posing major problem in horticulture production because of slow initial growth. Weed reduces crop yields, lowers the crop quality, act as an alternate host for many pests and diseases, and also have some allelopathic effect on crops. Weeds are interfere with vital farm operations like weeding, fertilizer application, herbicide application and harvesting. Both annual and perennial weeds are common in the reactions. Farmers in India mostly employ biological, cultural and chemical methods in controlling weeds on their farms. To achieve success in weed management in Nigeria for increased yields and quality, it warrants integrated weed management in horticulture crops. Weed management requires multifaceted approach built upon on understanding of weeds and the crop. Weed management may involve non-chemical methods, chemical methods, or a combination of these two methods. The major aim is to manage weed population to a level below that will cause a reduction in economic return for the farmer. The decision on which method is to be used on the environmental condition, available labor, weed population, the crop, desired management technique, and the cost of controlling weeds. Conclusion: in this session, we have discussed about integrating weed management concept and its definition, integrating weed management in agriculture and horticulture crops. In nutshell, integrated weed management is a method whereby all economically, ecologically, toxicologically justifiable methods are employed to keep the harmful organisms below the threshold level of economic damage, keeping in the foreground the concepts of employment of natural limiting factors. IWM is the rational use of direct and indirect control methods to provide cost effective weed control. Every farm needs to be evaluated on an individual basis to determine the most efficient and economical weed control program. Farmers need to look ahead and plan their weed control programs as a long-term practical measure. In order to develop an integrated weed management program, it is necessary to think strategically about how best to utilize all available weed control methods. This is needed in combination to give the best overall result for each crop and each rotation by developing a checklist of options as a useful tool for farmers.